what's special about the next session is that it talks about, for the first time, comprehensively and at length about India's first female star and co-founder of Bombay Talkies, along with a sprinkle of early Indian cinema's history and its first major actors such as Ashok Kumar, Leela Chitnis, and Dilip Kumar. And we've got an award-winning author and playwright with us on this one. She writes both fiction and non-fiction. She's been a part of television as an anchor, and she's been a producer for over 20 years before becoming a writer. Now, you know her well for her book, Darling Ji, which is the true love story of Nargis and Sunil Dutt. And this one is going to be pretty interesting as well. सवाल होंगे CLS chairperson Dr. Sumita Mishra के, और जवाब हम जानेंगे किश्वर देसाई जी से. Well, over to you, Sumita ma'am and Kishwar ma'am, to take it forward.
Welcome and good evening, friends. Welcome, Kishwar ji. It's a pleasure to have you here with us. And I'm
Thank
really
you so much.
I'm really looking forward to this session. Well, friends, I would like to tell you a little more about Kishwar ji, because she is a true example of a multifaceted personality, a woman of many, many parts, and each part outstanding and so inspirational. Kishwar Desai is an award-winning author and playwright who writes both fiction and non-fiction. She's worked in television as an anchor and produced for over 20 years before becoming a writer. She's the chairperson of the Arts and Cultural Heritage Trust that set up the world's first partition museum in Amritsar. And that's something I really want to know more about, Kishwarji. She has also helped to install the statue of Mahatma Gandhi outside Westminster in the UK. And when I told my daughters this, they were just blown away. They said, we thought it had always been there. I mean, how could it not? So that again is something that fills me with so much inspiration and gratitude for the steps that you have taken for India as an ambassador of India. She's the author, as Niharika mentioned, of Darling Ji, and her first book, this was her first book, non-fiction. She then switched to fiction, and her first novel, Witness the Night, won the Costa First Novel Award in the UK, which was followed by two others, Origins of Love and Sea of Innocence. And this trilogy featuring Simran Singh as the detective of sorts behind in each novel, has now been optioned for a web series. And today we're also going to be talking about her latest book, which is titled very tantalizingly, The Longest Kiss. And it is a book which talks about Devika Rani, India's first female superstar, I would say, who was such a force in herself. But what most people may not know is that Kishwar ji also has a deep Chandigarh connect. She studied here. She was born in Ambala and she studied in Chandigarh. And she was one of the first people who believed in CLS, who believed in literati, and supported us by being here with us physically in 2013 when we had our first literati. So thank you again for joining us today, Kishwar ji. Can I call you Kishwar ji instead of Lady Kishwar?
No, call me Kishwar. Please call me Kishwar. Then I can also call you Sumita and dispense with the G. Otherwise, I'll have to call you Sumita G. And then we'll be formal. Yeah, please call me Kishwar.
Okay, so tell us about your journey. I mean, how did you move from TV journalism to nonfiction, then fiction, then being a sort of global ambassador for India, whether it was the Gandhi statue or even staging the Jallianwala play, which you have done internationally, or the Partition Museum, something which is a one of its kind. Tell us a bit about that journey, which sounds so impossible, if you hear it.
Thank you so much. Firstly, I want to thank CLS. They're doing such a great job. And under your chairpersonship, I should say, it will do even better. And I'm honored to be actually speaking to you, because you're a woman who's achieved so much in her own right. And therefore, thank you so much for keeping the spirit of literature alive, even while handling a very strenuous job, I'm sure, as a bureaucrat. So basically, My journey doesn't seem to be as complicated, I'm sure, as yours, but it has been an interesting journey. And I have to say spent many, many wonderful years in Chandigarh. I even worked at the Indian Express when it had just started. So I have fantastic memories of that lovely city.
Invite you back. Soon.
Yes, I would love to. I would really love to come back soon. What has been actually wonderful for me has been that when you have a dream, I think this is common to a lot of people, but I would love to reiterate it again, is that when you have a dream and you're passionate about something, please follow that dream, because one of these days it is going to come true. And in fact, it is true that most people, when they recognize that you're doing something with complete honesty and with complete dedication, they also join that journey. So it becomes actually something which is, you know, is multifaceted, as you said. Sometimes you meet some fascinating people along the way, and each one of them, none of this would have been possible if I hadn't got a lot of support from my family, from my children, from my husband, from everybody who has been there along the way, who has supported what I have done. Out of all the very many things that you have named, and I'm sure that is you know, similar, if anyone were to sit down and say I have done this, it would be a very long list. But in my case, no, the things sorry,
you're very modest.
No, I'm sure even with you it would be the same. But there are a few things that I do believe completely did transform me. And some of those moments are to be treasured. And I think one of the major things was when one went into television. That was a journey which was at that time, you know, when we started working in television, there were no television 24/7 channels. You had to practically do everything yourself, right from the editing to sometimes even the camera work to writing the script. So it was, you know, it was a very challenging period to start in television like that. But I was fortunate again that one managed to work with very good people, such as the team at NDTV, at TV Today, which is India Today. And they gave me loads of opportunities. As I said, you know, when you work hard and people see that, then they're willing to give you the chance. And what astonishes me, even when I look back sometimes, is that I became an anchor when I was close to 38 or 39 years old with two children. And, you know, and it was like amazing that I was given an opportunity to do that. And then, of course, I was given an opportunity to even set up a television channel. And I was very keen to do that because I felt the, you know, Punjabi language is such a beautiful language, but somehow it just gets lost because, you know, all that people talk about is, you know, all the wonderful swear words you can use in Punjabi, but they forget that we have the most gorgeous, you know, love poetry. We have the most fantastic plays. And of course, the Gurbani itself, such amazing, amazing poetry and Sufi elements within it, you know, which are often unappreciated. And so I set up a Punjabi channel, you know, along the way, which was like from scratch. And it gave me great pleasure. And until today, I do believe we had such a fantastic team working there. We were able to create some wonderful, you know, pieces of theater, film. We filmed some of Amrita Pritham's short stories, for example, just to give you, and we even got Mahesh Bhatji to be involved in that whole production. We did a lot of very fascinating, got Khushwant Singh's blessings for the channel. We did a film on Maharaja Ranjit Singh. I mean, we did a lot of very interesting, but I'm talking about a very long time back. So I guess that, but the, you know, learning along the way, having to do different things and trying to make a success of it, and recognizing the fact, I mean, there were so many people who recognized that even though, you know, I was doing these adventurous things, they were all there to support me. And for that, I'm exceedingly grateful. And it would be the same for the books that I've written, for the you know, for even the Partition Museum, had we not got the kind of support that we received from just people who recognize that we as a country, you know, in India, we need to preserve our own history, even if it is the history of Bollywood, if it is the history of partition, if it is the history of any period in time, we need to do our bit. Otherwise, that history is either soon kind of drifting away from us or not being properly, you know, properly recognized by the world. And we should be proud Indians presenting our own story to the world rather than getting other people to tell it.
That's so, so beautifully said, because, in fact, I think that's one of the weaknesses of Indian society, that we have not adequately or sufficiently or eloquently enough documented our own history, and as you said, presented it to the world. Our narrative needs to be out there, it needs to be heard, it needs to be recognized. Coming to Simran Singh, now she's not your stereotypical heroine, and so where did you get the idea for that? Is it based loosely on some real person or some real incident or event that you encountered, and then, you know, it was the starting point of the book?
Thank you for that question. I think it was very relevant at the time when I wrote the book, which is, again, about 10 years ago, the Simran Singh series, when it came out. It was published in the UK as well as in India. And in the UK, as you said, it got this wonderful first novel, the Costa First Novel Award. I think what people liked about Simran Singh and what I had tried to put into her was a modern woman, a woman who makes up her own mind, who decides whether she wants to get married or not. And she's unmarried, she's middle-aged, and her mother keeps ringing her up and saying, you know, I've just found a boy, when are you going to get married? You know, the usual story that most women go through in their lives. And I also decided to make her a very independent woman who could decide for herself that she could have relationships without marriage. And I think I kind of imbued a lot of things that I saw happening around me, but which were not reflected in the kind of characters that you saw in Indian literature, at least at that time. Now you're seeing a much more, you know, a variety of Indian characters in cinema, in Indian women characters, I mean, in Indian cinema or in books. But at that time, I felt there was a big hole, you know, where these kind of sort of different, off the beaten track, middle-aged women characters were being depicted. So it was you know, great opportunity for me to try and create this kind of independent woman. And I think that's why the book did well. It was translated into many languages, and it did well abroad, you know, and even in India, it was translated into, I think, definitely Hindi, but abroad, it was translated in Chinese, which I thought was amazing. And I still get a couple of fan mails every now and then from China, you know, people who've read the book and have really liked it. So I think that independent woman, detective, come social worker, was a character that a lot of women could identify. Some of the things within her spoke to the women readers. And that's why the book did well, yes.
Yeah, I think it would have resonated more with real women that, yes. are, you know, we have all these sides to us and not just the laid out path, so to speak.
Right.
Coming to your most recent book, The Longest Kiss. Devika Rani is not somebody who is current or who is maybe at the top of our recall, especially for today's generation. So how did you think of writing a book about her and her life?
Yeah, well, it was actually quite by accident, you know, because as you very, very rightly said, she is not someone that we have celebrated enough, because her narrative, as I discovered when I started doing the research, like many other women's narratives, was hidden behind the shadow of the men whom she supported wholeheartedly, whom she married, but who did not give her the complete, it was not something that she herself did also, nor did the era or the time that she lived in gave her the complete recognition for all that she had achieved. But I actually came across her when I was doing my first book on Indian cinema, which was Darling Ji, which is the true love story of Nargis and Sunil Dutt. Again, I was very fascinated with the Nargis, and had gone to the National Film Archives in Pune to actually look at her early films, because some of the films are not available, you know, like Kismat and so on. It's not available anywhere to be viewed. So I'd gone there, and I, whilst I was looking at contemporary actresses of that period, I came across these films of Devika Rani's, which I thought were incredible. I mean, like, she's so beautiful and so forgotten. And then, of course, I started digging deep, whatever was available. Unfortunately, there wasn't very much at the National Film Archives for me to go with, I mean, to kind of be able to research her more. But I found quite a lot in Himanshu Rai, her first husband. And so I was very intrigued. I took all those copies of the films, brought them back, and said, I'm going to write this book. But wherever I went, I did not find any archives. It was so strange, because this is one of the biggest studios that was set up at that time. And, you know, we are talking about 1930s, 1940s. It was the establishment of Indian cinema. So many great actors, as you yourself mentioned, like Ashok Kumar, Leela Chitnis, Raj Kapoor, but not only discovered by this wonderful team of Himanshu Rai and Devika Rani, but some of them were even named by her, you know. So it was incredible for me that this was forgotten. So Sumita ji, it took me a long time to piece the story. It was actually 10 years of just, I was doing various other things. You mentioned the Gandhi statue, you mentioned other things. I was working throughout, but I kept looking out for some archive that could be available on about her. And so it was quite tough. I had to go to Bangalore, I had to go to Bombay, I even went to New York, I went to Australia, wherever, I mean, we did, I was doing other things along the way, but on all the journeys, wherever I went, I would always be looking out that somewhere there must be something about her. And what was incredible is, as I said, when you have a dream and you have a passion and you're like totally dedicated to it, somewhere a door opens. And in one of those places, I found a box of letters, which were written by Devika to Svetoslav, her second husband. And in those letters, she's completely frank. Those letters ran sometimes into 20 pages, 30 pages. And he, of course, was also writing similarly very long letters. But from there, I pieced together. And then I realized, as I had done even with in Darling Ji, was that the world did not actually know the truth about her. You know, who she was, what she had achieved. And fortunately, then along the way, I also came across a lot of letters and papers, original documents from Bombay Talkies, which included the board meetings which were held. So I ended up with like two huge suitcases full of documents. Some of them, I think one day I was trying to count them and I said, it's like almost like 4,000 different. And then I had to piece it all together, because no matter who I spoke to, even, you know, experts in the field did not actually know the real story of Devika Rani. So this was for me a huge journey and a great experience. Yeah.
Can you share with us some, you know, you did so much research. Can you share some startling discovery or something that about her, either as an actor or as an entrepreneur or as a woman, that I leave to you? I mean, something that, you know, you said, oh my God.
Yeah.
Something.
I think the first shocking thing that happened was when I was going through the letters, and I have to say, I had to read that letter many, many times to see that I had got it right. I couldn't believe it, was that Himanshu Rai was used to abuse her, meaning he used to beat her. He was physically violent with her. Now, and this was something that she has documented very painstakingly in the letters that she's writing to Svetoslav, because Svetoslav was like a soulmate for her, you know. Initially, they had no plans of getting married, but through this whole thing of the letter writing, they get closer and closer. And at the end, she does marry him, her second husband. But it was, for me, a really horrific point of revelation, because I had always seen her as this gorgeous porcelain China doll, almost, you know, very beautiful, petite, very tiny, very bright, very intelligent, which I will also talk about in a minute. But I think that was for me the most shocking thing. Not only did he abuse her and was violent, but at times he was so violent that she would fall on the floor bleeding, and she would not be able, and practically faint, and then, you know, just recover, because there would be some, there was some loyal, you know, servants in the house who would help her. She never spoke about it. She just hid it from the world. Now, this is how far we have come in some ways, Sumedha ji, and some ways not. Even today, yes, behind closed doors, you might find some of the finest so-called, the best people in the world, you know, abusing their wives and being violent towards them, and, you know, and all those things. And the women never speak, you know, and they don't speak out of shame. But in Devika's case, it was very different. This was the other thing I learned about her. She did not talk about it, not because she was ashamed of it, but she felt that she always needed to present an image of a very strong woman to the world because of the things that she wanted to achieve. And she never, ever, she thought of herself as a career woman. That's another thing. In the 1930s, she's talking about herself as a working woman, as a career woman, and things like that. And somebody who's independently earning her own money. And she didn't want people to feel sorry for her. She didn't care what people thought about her, actually, because the second most shocking thing, of course, which we know about, but which she does not refer to in the letters, was when she publicly ran away with her, with a married man, you know. And so the two things are linked. One was her desire for independence, which led her to do this. But that became public knowledge. While she was able to hide what was happening in her own home, but when she, of course, ran away with her leading star, Najmul Hasan, and they go off to Calcutta and try and join a rival studio there, it became public knowledge. So this was, and that led to the rise of Ashok Kumar and so on. The other, you know, elements, this was, of course, about her personal life, which is, and it's quite well documented, because she keeps on repeating this, that, you know, I have so many scars. If I were to show you my wounds, you would understand what kind of, you know, terrible times I have gone through, and things like that. And Svetoslav is very, very sympathetic, because he says, you are what you are. You've been through what you have. And I accept you in whatever, you know, whatever you've been through. So he was, in a way, a very evolved, very supportive husband. The other thing, very quickly, is that about her ascension to Bombay Talkies. Now, normally we think of women, again, you know, she was already a widow. She was only about 32 years old. She was already a widow. Himanshu had died. And, you know, the way she takes on Bombay Talkies, it was a lesson. It's a lesson on how women, if they stick to their guns, they can achieve whatever they want to achieve. And she does that. She does it through very careful buying up of the shares. Now, please remember, she's not an MBA. She's not even, you know, she's only completed a school education. She has been through many, many difficult times with all of this. And of course, there is another, you know, kind of thing which happens to her when she discovers her husband has a child by another, by a German woman. So that's where, you know, the book and the letters, because I even got the letters from the German woman to Himanshu Rai, you know, talking about that, you know, what kind of a man are you, abandoning your own child and things like that. So I think through those hardships, she probably learned her lesson that a woman needs to be independent. She cannot be dependent on any man. And how she plots her way to the top of Bombay Talkies, it is quite amazing. And ultimately, all the people who want her out, she gets them out. You know, so this was, and it's all documented. It's nothing that I have made up, but I did have to piece together all the, you know, the meetings, the board meetings of Bombay Talkies, and sort of go through newspaper articles, go through other narratives that people had written and put that whole thing together. It was a very tough book to write, but I'm glad that I managed to do it because she's a fascinating woman.
You know, you have, firstly, what an incredible drive for achievement. You know, I think that's what her life exemplifies. And you mentioned rightly about, you know, the shame that women feel, no matter how, you know, privileged they might seem if they are facing domestic abuse, because it disempowers you. And I was going to ask you next, you know, as to what the message would be from her life, but you just answered that for me by saying that, you know, with self-belief and determination, a woman can, you know, can move beyond the boundaries that might exist. Even if the world is trying to box you in, it's up to you to sort of unbox or to break those barriers and actually, you know, actualize what you want to be. I do hope that this fascinating book, that we see it on the big screen, because I think it's a film just waiting to be made. And I personally would love to see one of our current stars, you know, star is Devika Rani, and maybe try and bring that mixture of fragility and steel that that you have brought out so well in your book onto the screen.
Thank you. Yes, actually, it has been optioned by a studio because of the confidentiality. I cannot say which studio. Yes, and
I'm saying all the best for that, and we shall be waiting.
Yeah, I hope so. And I hope that, you know, as you said, one of our big stars, in fact, one of them did reach out to me, but by that time it had already been taken up by one of the other big studios. So I'm hoping that this story, this narrative will reach the big screen or even on Netflix or Amazon, whatever. But it needs to be told. It needs to be told.
It needs to be told. And I think that's really breaking news for all your readers and viewers today, that we are going to be seeing this on a bigger screen. I'm going to come back to something else that you have done, which, as I said, moved me and impressed me very deeply. Two things, in fact. One would be the statue of Mahatma Gandhi in London and the Partition Museum in Amritsar. Can you briefly tell us a bit about those?
Yeah. Well, thank you, because this was something my husband and I did together, was setting up of the Mahatma Gandhi statue in London. So the way there was a series of, you know, things which happened, which are too detailed to go into. But basically, we were asked that if we would be able to put up the statue of Mahatma Gandhi in Parliament, outside Parliament, sorry, in the Westminster Square. And there was this prime position which was there, and this was in 2015. And my husband first took up the challenge, and then we had to set up a trust. I joined him in the trust. And then the challenge there was that within, I think, 3 or 4 months, we had to raise something like £1 million, because all the statues, unlike in India where the government puts up the statues, here mostly they are done through public donations and contributions. So the contribution can be anything, like, you know, you can receive £5 or you can receive £1 million. It can be anything. So it was Sumitaji, very challenging, because, you know, we had to negotiate our way very carefully through donors, because, you know, there are rules and regulations here. I'm right now in London, so I'm saying here. There are rules and regulations about how these things are done. And you have to, my husband is a member of parliament, so we have to be very, very correct in everything we do. You know, we cannot do anything wrong. So one of the things which was very bluntly put to us is that there can be no names. You know, like if a donor is giving it, of course, you will acknowledge him, you know, maybe on your website or something, but you cannot put this statue of Mahatma Gandhi has been put up by XYZ, you know, that cannot be done at all. So this was difficult for us, because we had to raise £1 million within 4 or 5 months. And then one of the people who wanted to donate, you know, said that he would just write a check for £1 million and give it to us, but we had to put his name there. So we said, no, we can't do that. So it was very tough, you know, it was very difficult for us because people
but
would get
raised
upset.
More than £1 million.
Sorry, I'm we saying, did. We raised £1.5 million. And the nice bit was that the statue was set up with great ceremony, as you may recollect. Arun Jaitley ji came down, David Cameron was there, Amitabh Bachchan came, Gopal Gandhi came. I mean, it was like an amazing ceremony, beautiful ceremony when it was unveiled. And but the thing is that the money which was left over was given to other charities by our trust, in which, of course, other people also joined us from the UK, including the Murthy family, Narayan Murthy family. Rishi Sunak is now, of course, the finance minister here, but at that time, his family contributed. And then, of course, there were other people also who contributed towards it. But I'm saying that there was a huge, the Murthy family, of which I should say the other way around, Rishi is a son in law, they contributed. And there was a huge sense that this had to be done, but there were many challenges. Mm-hmm. Regarding the Partition Museum, this was a dream I had a very long time back, which I had been persuaded and dissuaded from doing many times before. And maybe, you know, it's okay because now I've come to realize that things happen at the right time. So when this time round, in again, after we did the Gandhi statue, I realized that Indians are interested in philanthropy. This had not occurred because most of us think ke hum sirf temples ko paise dete hain, you know, yeah, maybe now they're starting giving for education and museum is part of continuing education. So then I felt that maybe if we approach people, and because it's a huge thing, it's being done exactly like you do museums abroad, where many people contribute, and that's not a Sarkari museum. It's for the people, by the people, and it tells their narratives. We do not talk about, the people who are governing or ruling. They are there, present in the documents, but the major story is about the impact of the partition on the people of India and how much suffering and trauma they went through, and yet how they rose to become nation builders. So they're very, very inspirational. They're tragic stories, but they're also very inspirational stories in the museum. It was very tough. Again, another thing which took, I don't know, we didn't sleep. None of the team slept. We were a very small team, about just four or five of us. Or koi sota bhi nahi tha, and roped in my husband, roped in all the, you know, various people who were, you know, historians and educationists and things like that, who could, you know, help us with the historical bit. And all of us, including me, were going around recording oral histories and doing it all ourselves, because we needed, it was a race against time. Because you can imagine, it was done in 2017, which was 70 years since India's independence and partition, when we opened the museum. And Sumita ji, if you walk around already, because we recorded those stories and they're playing in monitors all around, when you walk through, you will notice that so many of them have already passed away. You know, for example, like Kuldeep Nayyar and so on, you know. So we were very conscious of that this is a risk. And even for the one that is now coming up in Delhi, there is the second one now. At the Darashiko library building. We are again in a race against time to try and complete that, because we want to, for people to understand the huge impact of how Delhi was completely transformed after the partition of India. It totally changed. So we've documented all of that, and we're hoping to inaugurate this museum next year.
You know, all I can say honestly is I feel like saying thank you. I feel like saying thank you to you, for the Mahatma Gandhi statue from all of us fellow Indians, because as I said, that statue needed to be there, and you were instrumental in making it happen. And the Partition Museum again is such a valuable part of our history of the oral histories that you recorded that are actually vanishing, because there are very few people left of the generation that actually suffered partition. And I think it's a very important piece of history that has been caught in time for the people of Punjab, for the people of Haryana, for the people of Delhi in particular, because these areas, these cities saw saw the full impact of this humongous migration of peoples across the border.
But I just want to say that we do also have, we've dedicated one gallery, to Bengal and also to Sindh. And we're trying to do the same even in Delhi to, capture more stories about other communities, not just the Punjabi community. Yes.
True. I am getting some messages that we might need to wrap up, but, I have to ask you you must be so used to it, any advice for new authors, but more importantly, I want to ask you, living such a multifaceted, multidimensional life, and as a woman, you have seen the world change. As a woman in the professional sphere, dealing with the world on your own, you have seen firsthand the challenges as well as the changes that have been happening maybe in the last 5 to 10 years, because the world has changed a lot since, I can see the changes for my daughters compared to what I experienced. And you have seen that in India, abroad, on a global scale. So what's your message or your takeaway for women, for young women in particular?
Yes. Yeah, I think never fear the patriarchy. That is something which a lot of women get overwhelmed by, because there are still many more men out there. If you want to be a working woman, or even if you want to do anything else in your life, you want to be in the creative zone. I think you have to be fearless. You cannot be scared of the patriarchy, because the patriarchy is there and will exist, by the way, for a very long time. So at every step, you have to be very conscious. And I think if you, rather than fearing them, most men, if you make them your partners or you bring them on board, then that is also a good way to move forward through discussion and through, of course, it's not always possible, as we have ourselves seen in the world of Me Too and, things like that. So those kind of issues are going to constantly be there. But I think if you choose wisely and do not get away by quick fixes, take the hard route sometimes, but you can make it. Ultimately, I am very optimistic. I'm sure tomorrow belongs to the women of this world. So I'm sure we're going to be ruling the globe very soon. And that is something which I am very, very optimistic about. And please, we must bring up the next generation. Whatever it is, whether it's our daughters or their children, to understand that it's an equal world, that it has to be equal for men and women. So I think in every home, if we can just make that message come through, it'll be much, much simpler for women moving forward. And about the authors, authors, just again, just write. I think this was advice which was given to me by a friend many years ago, that jo bhi karo, even if you're writing 500 words a day, just write, because then slowly, slowly the book will emerge. And then, you will be a writer. Now, whether the book gets published or not is another story, but at least you would have written something that you have enjoyed working on.
Thank you for both those different sets of advice. And I particularly think that, I think it's very wise advice. And again, you need to have been everything, wife, mother, and successful professional, to realize that you need to build partnerships and that it's not an adversarial world necessarily.
Absolutely. And, I agree that.
And that you need to raise both daughters and sons differently, ready for an equal world, ready for partnerships, ready to cooperate, collaborate, and build that brave new world that we are talking about. It has been lovely, Kishwarji, talking to you. And I, for one, can keep chatting easily for the next half an hour, but I have some horrible responsibilities as festival director, so I am going to have to just thank you. Lots of gratitude and lots of love from all of us in India. Thank you so much, Samijaji.
It was a wonderful, wonderful conversation. And yes, Now I'm really longing to sit down and meet you and have a cup of coffee with you.
Yes,
in real.
Call you back. Yes.
Thank you.
Hopefully for Literati 2022. And maybe before that, we will be having news of the longest kiss on the screen. Thank you so much.
Thank you.